Good day. I'm Elsa Mintz, Professor and Director of the Research Unit for Self-Directed Learning at the Northwest University. We are going to discuss the new IHOSIS book publication, Self-Directed Learning Research and its Impact on Educational Practice, edited by myself and my colleague here today. This book is Volume 3 in the Northwest University Self-Directed Learning series, published by IHOSIS. We will be sharing with you the contents of this new book publication that was devoted to self-directed learning research and its impact on educational practice. The importance of self-directed learning for learners in the 21st century to equip themselves with the necessary skills to take responsibility for their own learning for life cannot be overemphasized. This book contributes to the discourse on creating disposition towards self-directed learning among all learners and adds to the latest body of scholarship in terms of self-directed learning. Self-directed learning, according to Knowles, refers to a process in which students take responsibility for their own learning with or without the help and assistance of others. During this process, they determine their own learning needs, set their own learning goals accordingly, identify their own learning resources and strategies to reach the goal, and eventually determine if they have achieved the goal. This process of determining own learning needs, setting of learning goals, and achieving the learning goals can then proceed for life. In the first volume of the Northwest University Self-Directed Learning series, book series, we focus on self-directed learning for the 21st century and its implications for higher education. And in this book, we more specifically focus on the impact of self-directed learning research on educational practice, where researchers in self-directed learning share their research findings. We are all aware of the fact that we need to equip learners with skills to be able to succeed in this rapidly changing world where knowledge quickly become obsolete and where memorization of information will not necessarily equip learners with the necessary skills for the 21st century and specifically the fourth industrial revolution. Although self-directed learning initially stemmed from adult education, self-directed learning researchers have extended their wings to all sectors of education, from early childhood to tertiary education. The importance of self-directed learning has gained momentum as the demand for skills to cope in a rapidly changing technology globalized world increased. Although some of the interventions reported in this book are focused on higher education and some of the researchers highlight the advantages of incorporating active learning strategies like cooperative learning when attempting to develop any learner's self-directed learning. From different perspectives, the chapters in this book are authored by different researchers, mostly from the research unit Self-Directed Learning at the Northwest University. Although eclectic, the chapters are closely linked together around self-directed learning as central theme and contributing to the body of scholarship in self-directed learning. I now hand over to my co-editor.
G'day. I am Roxanne Bailey, Senior Lecturer in Computer Science Education and Sub-Area Leader in the Research Unit Self-Directed Learning at the Northwest University. Allow me to give a brief reflection of the exciting chapters included in this book. This collection of scholarly research on self-directed learning starts in Chapter 1 with Jachels' unique personal reflection of a researcher in the field of self-directed learning, in which he provides guidelines to define and understand self-directed learning research. The next four chapters, chapter 2 to 5, deal with interventions in higher education to enhance self-directed learning. Chapter 2 by Ace and Chigona determines undergraduate students' experiences in becoming self-directed researchers. They conclude that self-directed learning capabilities of students can be restricted by providing too much direction to students in terms of how they need to perform a task or assignment. The restriction of lecturers in terms of fixed curriculum outcomes can also limit self-directed learning opportunities. In the following chapter, Van Zyl and Mentz provide guidelines for deeper self-directed learning and indicate how the effect of the implementation of the guidelines in a computer applications technology class can improve students' inclination towards lifelong learning. In the ensuing chapter, Chapter 4, Bosch and Loebscher use cooperative learning in a blended learning environment in higher education contexts and indicate how a teaching presence can be established by the facilitator to enhance self-directed learning. Bundt and Grosser conclude the interventions in higher education in Chapter 5 by discussing the relationship between critical thinking and self-directed learning and report on a puzzle video game cognitive enrichment program for the development of critical thinking among first-year B.Ed. students. Chapters 6 to 8 report on self-directed learning research on teachers in different contexts. Verster, Mentz, and de Toibrits in Chapter 6 focus on the relevance of teachers gaining control and autonomy over their own curriculum as praxis when looking from the perspective of a self-directed learning capability approach. They conclude that teachers with a traditional curriculum stance only utilize limited self-directed learning capabilities, while teachers with a contemporary curriculum stance utilize more self-directed learning capabilities. In Chapter 7, Mentz and de Beer report on a professional development program for teachers to enhance self-directed learning and indicate the versatility of cultural historical activity theory, or CHAT, as a research lens in self-directed learning inquiries. In the following chapter, Chapter 8, Sukarno, Loebscher, and myself, Bailey, provide valuable insights into the experiences of the facilitator of a technology-supported cooperative learning professional development program developed to promote in-service mathematics teachers' self-directed learning skills. The last two chapters focus on interventions with learners to enhance their self-directed learning skills. The value of cooperative learning is also evident in Chapter 9, where De Lange, Peterson, and Bried use cooperative learning as scaffold to develop grade 10 life sciences learners' self-directed learning skills. They found that cooperative learning indeed develops the learners' self-directed learning skills. Finally, in Chapter 10, Geduld and Ndekane indicate that learners need self-regulation skills to become self-directed in their learning. Their findings revealed that the quality of parental involvement and the extent to which parents develop their children's self-regulated learning skills are highly influenced by their parenting styles, their educational levels, and their socioeconomic status. They recommend guidelines as to how parents can be supported to develop their children's self-regulated learning skills with homework activities. Back to you, Prof. Elsa.
Collectively, the contribution in this book illustrates the diverse context and facet of research on self-directed learning and the meaningful changes possible from strategies such as cooperative learning to enhance self-directed learning. Together, these chapters provide insight into self-directed learning research and its impact on educational practice. We hope you will enjoy this book and assist us in taking self-directed learning into all education sectors. Thank you.